It's not the pale moon that excites me, that thrills and delights me. Oh no, it's just the nearness of you. It isn't your sweet conversation that brings this sensation. Oh no, it's just the nearness of you. When you're in my arms and I feel you so close to me, all my wildest dreams come true. I need no soft light to enchant me if you'll only grant me the right to hold you ever so tight and to feel in the night the nearness of you.
It's not the pale moon that excites me, thrills and delights me. Oh no, yes, just nearness you. It is your sweet conversation that brings this sensation. Oh no, yes, just the nearness of you. When you're in my arms and I feel you so close to me, all my wildest dreams come. Yeah. I need no soft lights to enchant me if you only grant me the right to hold you ever so tight, yeah, babe, and to feel in the night. Bathing in his
It's not the pale moon that excites me, that thrills and delights me. Oh no, it's just the nearness of you. It isn't your sweet conversation that brings this sensation. Oh no, it's just the nearness of you. When you're in my arms and I feel you so close to me, all my wildest dreams come true. I need no song to enchant me if you'll only grant me the right to hold you ever so tight and to feel in the night the nearness.
It's not the pale moon that excites me, the thrills and delights me. Oh no, yes, just nearness you. It is your sweet conversation that brings this sensation. Oh, love, yes, just an image of you. When you're in my arms, and I feel you so close to me. All my wildest dreams come true. I need no soft lights to enchant me if you only grant me the right.
Friends, we come today to remember and to give thanks to God in thanksgiving for the life of Bruce Frederick Houghton. My name's Keith Walker. I'm a chaplain here at Narrabeen Vets, and it's my privilege to be with you today. There are three reasons that I know of that we have a funeral. It's a time, firstly, for relatives and friends to say goodbye and to remember the ones that they love. Secondly, it's an important part of healing, a part of that healing process. There may have been things that you would have liked to have said, told Bruce, and that's no longer possible. And you need to confront those emotions today. And thirdly, it gives us an opportunity to give thanks to God for who Bruce was and for his life. We're going to sing if you will. The words are with you there, if you would like. The hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
King of Heaven, to his feet thy tribute bring, ransom healed, restored, forgiven, who like me his praise should sing. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him.
Firstly, I just want to say thank you to everyone for coming today. Dad would be very chuffed. I'll see if I can get through this well. Our dad, Bruce, was born in Ashfield in 1934. From the local school, he went to Summerhill Opportunity School, aged 10 to 12, for 2 years. Where friends he made kept in touch and met through all the years. During this time, he was head chorister, otherwise known as head choir boy, at the St. James Church, King Street, Sydney, where he sung solo at weddings and funerals. He had a great singing voice as an adult too. The organist at St. James Church provided an amazing opportunity for Dad to attend the Conservatorium of Music, and he learnt piano there. He was an amazing piano player. He could play the most difficult of Rachmaninoff's works, who was his favourite composer. And he could play any tune by ear. His father returned from World War II and after much acrimony left his mother without support and went to Rabaul. Those events affected his schooling, and because of the poverty in which he was left, all his efforts were devoted to immediate survival. Living at Dulwich Hill, he attended Canterbury Boys High School. He also joined the Phillip Street Theatre in Sydney in his late teens and performed various plays. He was always good He always had a good stage presence and a phenomenal memory for everything, really. He could quote pages of Shakespeare and other literary greats and was able to speed read. His favourite books were science fiction and adventure books, and he could also speak fluent French. At school, he reached the intermediate level, which is the equivalent to year nine now, and then left to enter the wool trade because the family needed money. He worked as a trainee in Sydney wool stores and as a rouseabout in a number of shearing sheds at Kalulai. The whole valley where he was called the Valley of the Winds, between Dubbo and Tamworth. The first day he was there, it was a baptism of fire when they put a carpet snake in his bed. He must have passed that initiation, as at 16 he was given the job of their union rep, which he didn't really want. This solved the money problem, and later he completed a sheep and wool course conducted over 4 years at night, then landed a position as a wool classer and buyer. This lasted for about a year until he became allergic to wool. He joined the Army Reserves in 1953 during the Korean War and was about to be deployed when the war ended. He spent a lot of time in the artillery with the big guns, which we think exacerbated his hearing loss later in life. He then enrolled in a 2-year, 5-night per week matriculation course while employed as a clerk in the housing section of the public service. About this time, he and a friend, Ian Harper, sailed the yacht Nerida for the famous shipowner Thomas Hardy on weekends around the harbour. Many bottles of spirits were found hiding in places on the ship that Dad and Ian found, apparently squirreled away by Mr. Hardy. After matriculation, he was accepted in the Arts Faculty of Sydney University, where he studied at night and worked during the day. He then left the public service and joined Colgate Palmolive as a clerk in the newly formed Market Research Department. During this time, he met our mum, Margot, and they married in December 1964, the day after his 30th birthday. So on the 10th of December, it would have been his 90th birthday. And on the 11th of December, Mum and Dad's 60th wedding anniversary. At Colgate, he was in charge of all market research in Australia with an office of a staff of 10 and a field force of 250 in 28 cities. Considerable travel was involved, about 1 million miles in 10 years. As a consequence, his university studies suffered, and when offered a position as a research manager with General Foods, which paid a bit more and required much less travel, he took it. In this period, he was a member of the Market Research Society of Australia and a committee member of the society. He and three others wrote the first code of professional behaviour for market research in Australia. He was the first to use a computer for market research. And though in those days, the computer took up a whole huge room at Colgate. He was also the pioneer of focus groups in Australia as well. Tina and I were born during this time. He left General Foods after being offered a position to the group board of the Meyer Emporium in Melbourne. We all moved to Melbourne. Being the first position of its kind in retailing, we lived in a big, old, haunted wooden house in Beaumaris, overlooking Port Phillip Bay, built in the late 1800s with a ballroom upstairs where the floorboards creaked at night. And we had lots of fantastic parties there. After 5 years, we came back to Sydney, where he joined Nestlé as market research manager. He had 3 months training in Switzerland, where he attended a course at the Harvard Business School in Europe. We all went across to England first, got a camper van and toured around Europe before he started the course. I'm sure the movie National Lampoon's European Vacation was modelled off our trip. See me about the details later. We stayed in England and Scotland holidaying while he was in Switzerland working. Mum and Dad went on many trips overseas. They loved travelling when they could. On one of their travels, he had fun playing As Time Goes By on the grand piano in Rick's Bar, Casablanca, Morocco. During his stay at Nestle, he trained foreign affairs and trade officials in marketing and research, but after 8 years, he was most unhappy with the new senior management and left to start his own business. This was very disappointing to my sister and I, as we missed out on free chocolates he brought home, and there were many. His own business was quite successful with clients like Goodman Fielder, Unilever, Cotties, Bushels, etc. And he was also appointed as part-time lecturer in marketing at Hawkesbury Agricultural College and was made an associate fellow of the Australian Marketing Institute. As far as academia was concerned, he completed majors in psychology and education plus English 1. Work pressures made it impossible to finish his degree, even though he enrolled in a correspondence course with the University of New England. I must add that during that time he studied at university 3 to 4 nights per week. He worked as a waiter at night, playing the piano in a hotel, serving petrol in Dulwich Hill, and also crewing the yacht at weekends. I don't know how he did it. He didn't finish his degree, but he never missed it in his career. Other things were more important in his life. When Dad was 21, he received a birthday present from his estranged father out of the blue, but didn't pursue contact until another 4 years later. They reconciled and stayed in contact until his father passed away at 81. When we were little and lived in Beaumaris, he used to take us to the little shop on the corner on weekends. He would usually give us 20 cents and we would buy a bag of lollies. And when we had been really good, he gave us 50 cents and we could buy a huge bag. He told Tina once that 20-cent Violet Crumble bars would one day cost $1, and she was horrified. She instantly thought she would never be able to afford them, as 20 cents would not be able to get her a Violet Crumble. After retirement, he became the baked dinner expert, and we all enjoyed his cooking. He had some fabulous friends whom he really held dear. Ian and Keith Harper, Buddy Boosh, a.k.a. Charles, George Bigshaw and Des Pertel. Dad loved Diane Sean and thought the world of them as he did him. He enjoyed a drink and a good banter whenever they were together and his cheeky side would come out. Dad was always good with a joke and he could have written an excellent book of dad jokes. One ditty that comes to mind is... Mary had a little lamb. She also had a bear. Everyone had seen her lamb, but no one had seen her bear. Tina only just got that yesterday. and Di only got that today. Come and see me if you don't get that. He was so proud of both his grandchildren, Zoe and Lara, and loved seeing them. He just loved them. He also loved all of our dogs over the years, and this love originated in his childhood with his first dog called Stinker. He had a natural talent for nicknames, and there were many for us. I wish I had written them all down, but for your entertainment, here are a few. Dingus McFingus. Dinglepuss. Popsy and Topsy, Heckle and Jekyll, Dingle Bottom, Monkey Bottom, which was one of my favourites. We always said he should write a book about his life because it was so rich and incredibly interesting. He was generally interested in everyone and cared about other people. You couldn't but not like him, not just like him, but love him. His friend George and wife Marion, who couldn't make it today, describe Dad as a true gentleman, a fascinating storyteller with a vast depth of knowledge and sharp wit, with an analytical mind, but most importantly, a great friend. He was all this and much, much more. He was kind and generous and funny and loving, sensitive, intelligent and engaging. We all had such a wonderful time with him. We loved him and he loved us all so dearly. Until we meet again, Dad. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilyn. On your sheet, we have a prayer that you may wish to say together with me. With this hope, we pray together. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Help us to live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Brendan is going to read to us our two readings. Thank you, Brendan. Sorry about that. Our life, the video.
Unforgettable. That's what you are.
Unforgettable, though near or far.
Like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more
unforgettable in every way,
and forevermore,
and forevermore.
That's how you'll stay.
That's why, darling, it's incredible
that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Forevermore,
that
someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Well, I'm certainly glad we didn't miss that, because that was beautiful. Thank you for that amazing eulogy, Merrily. And for those who don't know me, I am Merrily's cousin through Auntie Margot, the sister of my father, Keith, and Julie in the middle there. So I know some of you, but look forward to meeting you all afterwards. And thank you for the honour of being asked to do these two readings from the Bible today. So, Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. And John 14:1-6, Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Thanks again, and thank you to Bruce. We have amazing memories as a family from that Melbourne house. We went to Melbourne, but you all went to Sydney again, so we had to drive in the back of the Celica with my brother and I, squished in the back seat every year, but we had wonderful memories for, I don't know, 10 years in a row coming up for Christmas, and it was really special times. So great memories, and I love all the funny jokes as well that Bruce shared when we were there. A lot of wit, and as I got older, even some career stuff with his marketing amazing talents. So, yeah, he will be missed greatly, and thanks again for the honour of sharing.
Thank you, Brendan. Psalm 121 is about a traveller, probably a pilgrim, and they're travelling through country that they're very unsure of. And they're concerned for their safety. That's why they look to the hills. Where does my help come from? The hills are places from the high places. That's where you pounce. And so that's what's happening as they're going through. They're wondering who will help them. And that's when that answer is sure and given in the second verse there, "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." It's a bit like a second voice that comes in. I don't know if you've had that experience where you wonder about something and you're speaking to yourself, and then you feel like there's another voice that comes and speaks to you. And that's what's happening in this psalm. "I lift up my eyes. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over his people will neither slumber nor sleep." It's a It's a lovely reassurance for the person as they're, as I said, very unsure in a place where they're not certain where they're going and how they're going to get there. Will they get there? That voice comes to reassure them that God is there. It reassures them that the Lord watches and protects, and there's nothing that will distract him, nothing that will stop him from being with you all day, all night. That voice is telling you, because it's based on the reality of who God is. He is the God who has come for his people. He will watch over them, and he will watch over them. Thirdly, in the last bit, he will watch over them not just now, but forevermore. It's something like what Jesus said in John 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled, he says. Trust in God, trust also in me. And he spoke those words to his disciples who were very uncertain. They were very uncertain because he just told them he was leaving them. And in leaving them, they are wondering where to next. And so he assures them, trust in God, trust also in me. It is what is held out to us in the phrase, I am the way, because they said, we don't know the way, we're lost. But Jesus says, I am the way. And so in these uncertain times, this is uncertain. In the valleys of uncertainty in life, God wants us to know he is there for him, for you, for us, that through trusting that Jesus who promised to be with us, you might know that he is with you, that you might know his constant comfort, his care and protection. There are times in life that's more important than others. But one thing, it's always there. We're going to pray. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, it is you who have gave life to Bruce and sustained him over that life. We thank you. We read the words of the address. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointed my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord God, we thank you for the joys and for the pleasures that you gave Bruce in this life. We thank you for his many talents, for his energy. My goodness, what energy. How he used and enjoyed all the opportunities he could. He grabbed them with two hands and pursued them. Not only that, he had a great strength of character, a giving and friendly nature, his humour, his piano playing. Gracious Father, we thank you that he shared those things with so many people, and he shared them with us. We give you thanks, Father, as we ask that you would give us a due sense of your generosity. Give us a thankful heart, even in these sad times, as we are reminded of the life and death of Bruce. Lord Jesus, you taught us a prayer, and that prayer is on our sheet. If you will, please join with me in saying it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We move to the committal. I just wanted to read Revelation chapter 21, which is a book of great interest to many, but here at the end we are given this picture. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the dwelling of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying, neither shall there be any pain, for the old things will have passed away." Father, as it please you to give life to Bruce, to be with him through that life and to take it again, we now commit his body to be dissolved into that from which you formed it. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Eternal God, whose days are without end and whose mercies cannot be numbered, make us deeply aware of your love. Make us deeply aware of your presence with us and your promise to be with your people through that life, this life. Do this, we ask, that we might understand that in every experience of life, you are calling us to turn to you, that we might know that free gift of life in Jesus. Father, please comfort now those who mourn, help them this sad day, and assure them of your care. In Jesus' name, amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Please stand.